First, the master behind the monsters, special effects genius Ray Harryhausen.
Hello, I'm Ray Harryhausen, stop-motion animator.
For me as a child, there were all the other movies. And then there were Ray's movies. They were the films that looked different. Whether it was the Sinbad films, or Jason and the Argonauts, or 20 Million Miles to Earth, or whatever.
Ray's films always stood out as having better characters and performances of the characters and creatures in them than any other movies that were being made at that time. The creatures seemed to be alive, you know, and that was what was compelling about them.
Ray was trying to put on the screen things that people hadn't seen before. I became a great fan of stop motion, probably without even knowing really what it was.
Ray Harryhausen is one of cinema's legendary figures. A master of the art of stop motion animation, his films inspired many of Hollywood's leading special effects artists and directors.
I think there was a period when I just got into my early teens where I started to appreciate that there were people who were behind the camera in the filmmaking process and who were the artists, and you start to track the names and try to, you know, figure out, what does this guy do? Who is this Ray Harryhausen guy? What is stop motion animation? And you start to educate yourself as a fan verging on wanting to be a filmmaker yourself.
I used to study Ray's films a lot, see how he did it. I even went to Spain, where Seventh Voyage of Sinbad was done, and walked on the beach that the Cyclops was on to get some idea of how big the area was and how far back the camera could be to get, you know, the actors and the Cyclops or whatever in the same scene. You know, I could study him, and I could figure out sort of how he did it.
When people say, you know, when did you become a special effects guy? And I come on, I'm not a special effects guy. You know, I create characters. And hopefully emulate somewhat what Ray Harryhausen has given to us all.
Long before the animatronic and the computer-generated dinosaurs of Jurassic Park, Ray Harryhausen's stop-motion art brought prehistoric creatures back to life.
Dinosaurs were my first love. I used to have my father drive me out every 2 or 3 weeks to see these bubbling tar pits where they got all the bone. In the museum, of course, they had a lot of skeletons that they retrieved from the tar pit, which made it all the more interesting, I thought. And then the King Kong Wall was out in Culver City on the back lot of Pathay. And I used to ask my dad to take me out there so I could see the wall of King Kong. So King Kong played a very important part in my career.
The Oscar-winning fusion of stop-motion animation with live-action photography in King Kong made a lifelong impression on the young Californian.
I saw King Kong in 1933 when I was 13 years old and very impressionable. And, of course, I didn't know how it was done at that time. Stop motion was a secret. They kept it hidden for a good many years. And a friend of my father's worked in the studio at RKO, and he told me how it was done. And I got intrigued and started doing it as a hobby in my back garden, in my garage.
Ray Harryhausen came to me in 1939, and he had already started animating, and at that time he had a Brontosaurus animation model that he had done when he was just 13 years old. As a matter of fact, it's the first example of his work that he ever gave me. It's right there, the Brontosaurus, created by Ray Harryhausen when he was only 13 years old.
My first dinosaur, which was a Brontosaurus, it had one of these lamps that have a neck that stays put. I used that for the dinosaur's neck, and that was quite a thrill to see it move. Finally, it developed from a hobby into a profession.
Harryhausen's movie apprenticeship took on many different roles, from service in an army film unit during World War II to stop-motion fairy tales.
Finally, Hansel began to break off pieces of bread and drop them along the path. "See, Gretel," said Hansel, "when our basket is filled with berries, we shall follow the trail of breadcrumbs back to our house."
And then, in 1949, Harryhausen received an invitation from his idol, King Kong creator Willis O'Brien, to work on another giant ape movie, Mighty Joe Young. But stop motion in big-budget Hollywood features like Mighty Joe would soon be considered too expensive by the studios. And for the next 10 years, Ray Harryhausen was forced to practice his art in the wilderness of science fiction movies.
I think the thing that impressed me the most, being a kid, very young kid, when I saw Beast of 20,000 Fathoms, was the special effects. I probably was not following the story, and certainly the acting I could care less about, but to see that creature walking down the streets of New York City in such an animated style, so interesting in his motions and all, it was pretty neat.
In fact, there's a lot more attention paid in some of these pictures than there were to ape pictures of the period. A lot of the stuff with the emu in 20 Million Miles to Earth has a lot of scenes in it that are pretty remarkable in terms of creating from nothing but this little sculpture an actual creature that seems to have a personality.
My gloves. Where are my gloves?
Under the table.
Before 2001 A Space Odyssey, before Star Wars, you know, science fiction and horror were very disreputable genres. They were either late-night fodder or low-budget, cheapo, poverty row kind of pictures. And in a way, that was the world that Ray belonged to. But that's part of his charm as well. Of such stuff is cults made.
In my collection, I have two famous films of his. One is Earth vs. the Flying Saucers. And then there's It Came from Beneath the Sea. And, well, right here I have, there's the bridge from It Came from Beneath the Sea. Was attacked by an octopus.
It Came from Beneath the Sea was the brainchild of Charles Schneer, a young Hollywood producer. The film would mark the beginning of a professional relationship between Schneer and Harryhausen that was to last for more than a quarter of a century.
I got word from a friend of mine that this young man at Columbia Studios wanted to make a film about a giant octopus pulling the Golden Gate Bridge down. So that intrigued me, and he made arrangements for me to meet Mr. Schneer, and we met and seemed to click.
It was a great, I don't want to use the word romance, but it was a great teamwork. It was great teamwork on our part. I think he'll tell you that.
Charles watched out that we could get the live action made for a good price, and we made these very low-budget films, which became very popular.
Nobody paid any attention to us. Nobody said, why did you do this and why did you do that? We just did it, and when the picture was finished, they saw it. We had full control, artistic control, without any interference. That was worth the price of making a B picture as opposed to an A picture.
Incidentally, he didn't turn out to be an octopus because the budget was so low I had to cut off two tentacles, so he was actually a sextopus.
As the 1950s drew to a close, Schneer and Harryhausen grew tired of making monster movies. They began to look for new subjects for their stop-motion animation techniques, and they found it in the colorful world of myth and fantasy.
I saw Seven Before Descent about eight times the first week it came out.
It was promoted with this Dynamation logo as if it was the Second Coming, and it was brand new and it was in color.
We needed a sales gimmick in order to sell our pictures to the public, and I drove about 10 miles to the studio every day in California down Sunset Boulevard, and I happened to buy a new Buick made by General Motors, and I saw on the dashboard their trademark, they're going after their audience, called Dynaflow. And I thought that was magic. So I dropped the flow, kept the Dyna, and put Mation to it. And that became Dynamation and became a part of the language of the trade.
We wanted to get away from the mad monster trampling down cities. I destroyed Washington. I destroyed San Francisco, Golden Gate Bridge. I destroyed Coney Island in New York. And it gets tiresome. So we were looking for this new avenue, and mythology was ideal. In my youth, they made mythological pictures, but you never saw the mythological creatures. They'd always talked about them off stage. So I was bound and determined to put these creatures on the screen where you see a one-eyed cyclops. And it's not just an actor with one eye glued in the middle of his forehead.
From the minute it comes on with that fantastic Bernard Herrmann score, there was something really different and quality about this picture. Now, after the Cyclops appears in the first reel, almost nothing happens in this picture for the next half hour. And when you're watching it again, you go, geez, I've forgotten that there's no special effects. There's just a lot of people walking around in these palaces. But seeing the Cyclops moving and eating people and the giant rocks and the skeleton thing at the end, it was a very magical movie.
I always wanted to animate a skeleton. This was the first inspirational drawing I made. Now, I knew that you couldn't have a modern-day character such as James Bond fight a skeleton, that it would be comic. So I went back to the Arabian Nights and I found that you could believe that Sinbad would fight a skeleton.
I think it's virtually impossible for an audience to appreciate the painstaking hours and hours of work required to generate one single shot of 2 or 3 seconds in the stop motion process. And having sort of dipped my toe into those waters briefly as a stop motion animator for a few months, I can say it is probably one of the most grueling experiences of my life.
It takes a certain kind of mind to be able to say, okay, I'm going to be spending the next 5 weeks of my life trying to make these scenes come to life, because there is a certain amount of tedium to it, and it's extremely technical, and that's probably why there weren't that many people who did it.
You have to break down all the movements into static positions. You're actually making a series of still pictures.
There were times that he stayed in the studio the whole night, clicking off a frame at a time so that he could remember where he left off. And he'd just pull up a bed alongside the camera, and his foot was attached to a pedal that clicked off the frame.
Stop motion is a very solitary job. You know, the concentration is so specific and exact, and you can't lose it for a moment because you've got, you know, you've got 60 or 80 body parts that all have to move in a continuous direction and be advanced the right distance every single frame, or else it's not going to look right. So it's best to do it quietly, away from everybody. Don't lose that concentration. Don't answer the telephone.
If the telephone rings, and you go away to answer it, and you come back and you say, was that Hydra's head moving forward? And you'd wonder whether the third head was moving forward or backward. But one tries to overcome that. You have to keep the physiognomy in synchronization so that the movements look graceful. For example, I move it maybe a millimeter. I take this out and shoot one frame. Then I put this back, move it another millimeter, and shoot it, one frame of film. I've always used these machine shop tools so that you could put this in a position on the skeleton and then move it, and you know whether you've moved it a millimeter or 2 millimeters or 3 millimeters. If you move it irregularly, it tends to give a jerky effect. But if you take patience and time, you can get quite smooth animation out of that. And after you get hundreds of these, you finally get a bit of action that may last 1 minute or less than that, 30 seconds, 20 seconds. Of course, Jason and the Argonauts presented a different problem. We had 7 skeletons fighting 3 men. But here you see the introduction of the skeleton. In the actual Greek mythology, the rotting corpses come up out of the ground, and that wouldn't be very pleasant, and we'd probably have gotten an X.
The first Ray Harryhausen film I saw was Jason and the Argonauts, and of course it was the skeleton scene that just blew my head off.
Kill! Kill, kill, kill them all!
I've got 2 small boys, 4 and 6, and they love the Ray Harryhausen films. We're all on visiting it, and particularly that scene. There's just something about those skeletons.
Something about the tension, you know, they're standing there and there's a kind of face-off, a bit like a sort of Western face-off. Suddenly there's a shriek. And, you know, they do battle.
The actors had to rehearse ahead of time quite a number of times to get the feel of where their sword should stop. But the actors had a shadow box and pretend that the skeleton was there, of course. And that would be the piece of film that I would use to put the skeletons in.
You know, in those days, you didn't look for movies for the director. You went because of the star, except for Alfred Hitchcock, you know, an Alfred Hitchcock film. But I started looking for Ray Harryhausen's name on the poster.
I don't think anybody really ever went to Ray Harryhausen film for the acting. I mean, his leads in his films were always instantly forgettable. And it's quite interesting, just to bang on about my kids again, they watch Jason the Argonauts, they still don't really know which one is Jason.
With the seventh voyage of Sinbad and Jason and the Argonauts, Harryhausen and Schneer brought stop-motion animation back from the grave. Generations of children grew up enthralled by sword-fighting skeletons, giant dinosaurs, and other fantastic creatures.
They had a word in distribution at the time, I remember, the wonderful descriptive word called kidult. K-I-D-U-L-T. Maybe it's still used today. And that's the audience we were looking at. That's anything from 5 to 90, as long as they were kidults.
I remember very distinctly in the third grade seeing Mysterious Island. It made a huge impact, and it's still a very good film. I watched it with the kids just recently, and it holds up. They were mesmerized.
The crab I got from Harrod's department store, the fish department. We had it dismembered and so that I could put a mechanism in it to use for stop-motion photography.
And it's probably the only example in modern cinema where they then ate the special effect.
Yes, we had a lovely crab dinner afterwards. I guess Hitchcock would have been pleased.
That's the best crab I ever cooked. We'd have been more impressed, Mr. Spilett, if you'd put it in the pot by yourself.
Ray Harryhausen is admired for his artistic talents as well as his animation skills, and throughout his long career has drawn on classical traditions for many of his most famous creations.
The centaur from Greek mythology is a character I've always wanted to make and put on the screen in a convincing way. To combine the human torso and the horse's body is not an easy task. And I found that we had a lot of problems in that combination. But we finally got a centaur into one of our films, and that was The Golden Voyage of Sinbad.
Well, Ray was the ultimate vertically integrated creative entity, you know, so he would conceive of the character. Often he would work out the story to allow these characters to come into being. Then he would draw them, he would sculpt them, and then he would bring them to life through the craft of stop motion. You become the ultimate artist in a way. It steps off the page. It steps off its little pedestal as a sculpture comes to life.
I think he's particularly good at metallic sculptures. Telos, the man of bronze. You know, this, how do you get round the Colossus concept? Usually it's stone, but he makes him a man of bronze.
This is the original model of Telos, but you can hardly touch him because he's made of rubber. The original one has an armature with ball and socket joints, and he's made of rubber. And we tried to make him look like bronze. In fact, several critics criticized Telos for being jerky. They didn't realize that it was necessary to put over the idea that it was a metal statue that came to life. The same way with Kali. She was a metal statue in bronze, and we put sound effects of creaking noises in it to give it the metallic concept. This is an image of Shiva These idols with many arms always fascinated me. I always wanted to animate them, bring them to life as sculptures.
Ray Harryhausen combines two visual talents, really. Firstly, the talent of the engineer stroke inventor who grew up tinkering in his father's garage, you know, trying to make things work. And then there's the graphic skill, which also he learnt at art school.
Stop!
And in a way, it's putting those two thoughts together is so unusual, the sort of inventor-engineer and the guy who's a great visualizer.
Ray was a wonderful graphic artist, and just like the old Hollywood designers that used to show the clothes to the actress that she was going to wear in the movie, Ray's sketches were part of the inspiration of the whole deal. It was imbuing the actor with a sense of what they were going to actually be stepping into.
Ray sketched every single scene that was to be shot by a director. And Ray virtually directed where the scenes were to take place, how they were to take place.
I think when Ray was making his films, it was probably difficult for the directors and the actors to kind of understand what was going on, because at that time there weren't very many effects films being made. And they were, you know, look over there and there's a big creature that'll be there, but it's not there now. They'd say, what are you talking about? And it would just be hard to understand it.
The first thing I noticed on the set was something I'd never seen, which looked like a second unit camera that was attached to the earth with like tent pegs, and I'm thinking, what's this all about, you know? And he explained to me that even the slightest motion of the earth, you know, of any kind would cause a situation that would be undesirable in his stop motion work later. And that was fascinating to me, because that became a clue. Whenever I saw a camera tied down, I knew there was a monster coming.
With stop motion movies, they're really, the auteur is really the guy who's doing the stop motion. And it's quite possible that some directors have resented the control that Ray may have had to have over a given movie or a given sequence.
A lot of directors have said, I'm not necessary here. You can direct it yourself. And we explained to them that the commitments they are making not only was to the script, but was to the design. And if you want to move the camera 2 feet, it takes a national conference to talk about that.
Sometimes you get a director who isn't quite in harmony with that type of thing, and they want to do something a little different. But these pictures on their own are not director's pictures.
When you're a stop-motion animator, you're actually taking the place of an entire film crew. You are single-handedly creating a movie. So, in a way, you're the most unsung hero in Hollywood, but in another way, you're also the most pure auteur in Hollywood.
One of Ray Harryhausen's most impressive stop-motion sequences was created for Clash of the Titans, the film which marked his return to the world of classical Greek mythology.
This is the Medusa sequence from Clash of the Titans. It turned out to be one of the best sequences, I think, that I've ever done. I designed the whole sequence myself and edited it as well. We were a little worried at first about cutting her head off, because that was pretty grisly. And we had various versions of trying to decapitate her, as it's in the myth. But finally we ended up with the hero cutting her head off as described in the myth itself. I'm rather proud of that sequence. I think it has a wonderful atmosphere about it that some of our other scenes haven't had.
Of course, there are a lot of things in Clash of the Titans that were fun and Harryhausen-like, but overall, it all seemed to be a sort of a weak tea version of Jason and the Argonauts with a better cast.
I suppose the closest he got to proper actors was when he got Laurence Olivier and Chums in for the Clash of the Titans. But even then, you sat around waiting for the next monster to turn up.
What Ray was doing was so powerful in its own right that there's nothing that you could do in the moments in between his set pieces that could possibly live up to it. Certainly on the budget that those films were being made at.
The whole thing with the gods and the Olympus and that stuff, it just didn't seem like he was challenging himself. I mean, it really, all that kind of stuff had been done before by him, and I think better. And maybe he was disappointed with the film and decided that he didn't want to do anymore.
Clash of the Titans was Harryhausen's final journey into the world of fantasy. His talent has never deserted him, and there were plans for many more projects. But the veteran filmmaker called it a day after just over a dozen features in 25 years.
One gets tired being in a darkened room for a year while other people on the film have gone off and made three or four more pictures before you finish one. That was one of the factors. There were many factors, including some personal factors, which made me decide that I've had enough.
He didn't have a feeling for his craft, as great as it was, once the digital came in, once all the machines came in, where it took 80 men to operate the machines, it took him one man to do it. And he was not only disheartened and disenchanted by it, but felt that his era was rapidly drawing to a close.
And the irony of it is, the very filmmakers who had grown up enchanted by Harryhausen's work were now to consign his art to virtual extinction by their switch to computer-generated imagery, or CGI.
Now, this is an early test from Jurassic Park. And when we started, it was all going to be stop motion, really nice looks, you know, ways that the characters seemed to be sort of alive and looking around and stalking and all that. And they did a lot of these studies of how raptors might possibly move in the stop motion mode. When we started testing here at ILM, computer graphics, and we began a series of tests, and within, 3 or 4 months, we had our answer, and that was we could do it with computer graphics. And that's what we did.
Each generation of technology supplants the one before it. So when you look at films that are stop-motion animated, you have to look at them as a snapshot of the technology of its time. And the audience will constantly demand the newer, more realistic thing.
I've always tried to put a lot of stop-motion, or some stop-motion, into most of the movies that I've done. And it happens that the last film I did was almost entirely CGI with puppets. And it was amazing when I thought about how I would never have been able to make that film in stop motion.
You know, I think that was the breakthrough, is getting the technology to the point where you could not tell that the work was artificial.
I think that we probably have pretty much seen the last of stop motion.
But despite the now everyday use of computer-generated imagery, Harryhausen's fans believe that his films, like Our Love of Dinosaurs, will endure long into the next millennium.
Actually, Ray is not right for that world, for the modern world of computer-generated imagery and giant budgets and verisimilitude, where everything has to look more real, the era of hyper-reality, that in a way he's out of place in that world. You'd never get a Ray Harryhausen movie for $80 million. It would lose so much in the process.
The thing about stop motion is there is a magic to it that seems to be lacking in the digital process in modern films like Star Wars. You sit there and say, wow, that's great. Oh, they just did it with computers. There doesn't seem anything very exciting about that. But something about stop motion, I think, there actually is a little model that's moving about and someone has positioned it in every one of those positions.
What is so hard to put back into CG is the feeling of performance and character and dynamics of the motions that you can get so quickly with a puppet. And an animator can so quickly get by grabbing the puppet and moving it. And we're still struggling with trying to get those performances into our computer graphic characters.
When I started out, I couldn't find another kindred soul interested in stop motion, particularly in prehistoric and mythological imagery. But after all these years, more and more people have, shall we say, jumped on the bandwagon. I think our films have influenced a great many people, not only in the profession, but out of the profession. There were two professors in Canada who said if it wasn't for 1 million BC in Guangxi, they would never have become paleontologists. And that's rather satisfying to think we made more than just an entertaining film.
When I think of Ray, I think of him as a wonderful storyteller of the fantastic. I think of him as an actor. I think of the characters that he's created as having, you know, character and performance. And I never think of Ray as a special effects guy.
Nobody will ever come along and do what Ray did better, because nobody's going to be doing it. So there's a purity in that, you know, which will exist forever.
You look at the credits of Godzilla, and there's 47 model makers and 47 animators, and then you get to the computers, and the credits go on for about 10 minutes. On a Ray Harryhausen, there's one credit. Ray Harryhausen.
I'm grateful that this big gorilla set off this desire to do these type of films. And it was in the lap of the gods, the fickle finger of fate. We shot about 350 frames animation, didn't we?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, uh-huh.
And the rest are still pictures.
Yeah. So, do you miss it?
Well, I don't want to get back into it. So I have to put a wall up here. I do miss it a little, I must admit. Well, there is film in the camera.
There's film in the camera.
Okay.